Welcome. We'll start with the third chapter on political science for class 6th NCERT. This chapter talks about what is government. Now let's start with understanding the definition for the word government. Government, we can say, is a group of people who are working together as a community or a unit, and they try to serve for a kind of public purpose or have some public policy formulations that they do. So what are the three basic works that they do? The first is the executive role, the political role, and the sovereign role. So these are the three basic roles that are performed within the existing system of the society, that is the existing institutions, the laws, and the customs. So keeping all those in mind, there are various executive orders that are passed, the various political and sovereign powers that are granted. So all this come under the definition, or I can say the area of government. So let's say if there is a decision about working for a road or creating a new road, that would be ruled or laid down by the government. Then checking the price in the market, so price fluctuations for the everyday commodities like vegetables. So there recently there was a boom in the onion price. So examples like those are all regulated under the government bodies. Again, there are various social issues that are addressed by the government. So providing reservation to the minorities, providing reservation to STSCs, providing reservation or quota for a specific caste or specific group of people, sect of people, is again the area that government looks after. Again, running of the various basic services like railways. So then you have the postal services, the postal department, all this come under the government ambit, we can say. Now when we come on to the role of the government, as we said, all the things that we talked about are the basic idea behind decision making. So decision making is one of the major important ideas that are laid by the government. Again, protecting the right of the workers, protecting the rights of the minority groups, providing good health care if there is a natural disaster, providing facilities in terms of food, immediate habitation, all those is looked after by the government authorities. There are other NGOs which come into help. Again, there are certain court and legal matters that the government looks into. So basically we can say maintaining law and order, maintaining peace, creating a kind of leadership and executive system is a basic role of the government. Now there are various levels of the government that we will try to understand. If we look on to India as one country, we will say what is important is a good national government. So you have a national government or a national level government that would look around throughout the country. Then you have the state level government. So you have the various states here. Let's say example, I have demarcated few of those. So you have Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala. So you have the various states. These are looked after by the state level government. Again, within the states, you have further demarcation of smaller districts. So let's say within the state of Gujarat, you have further districts of Rajkot, Ahmedabad, Bharuch, and so on. So you have the district level, that is again a subset of the state level, and finally within the district level you have the local levels. Now these local level can further be divided as urban and rural. So you have the rural centers, the major rural centers, and the major urban centers, which would come under the local level governance. So you have the various levels. Now it's important that this national level incorporates all the state level, the state level incorporates all the districts within the state, and the district within the district incorporates all the rural and the urban areas within that district. So it's a kind of subset of one another. Now the next important thing is maintaining law and order. As I said, maintaining peace and law and order is one of the major works of the government. So what is important here is to make laws. Once the laws are formulated, the enforcement of the law is very, very important, because if a law is drafted and it's not implemented, that law is useless. So enforcing the law, now laws are enforced to curb the injustice or to work around the problem of injustice or inequality. So understanding the problem of injustice or inequality is another major area where the government works around. And finally, based on the laws and the enforcement, courts can give certain orders which have to be followed by the people or the residents. Now, the next important topic that we would move on is the philosophies and the types of governments. So we'll first understand the basic philosophies. There are two basic philosophies which are known as leftist and rightist. We also call those as left wing and right wing. Now this diagram would help you understand. This extreme corner is the leftist ideas and this extreme corner shows the rightist ideas. So you have kind of authority and individualism which is predominantly important for rightist philosophy. However, leftist philosophies are based on the idea of equality and liberty. So equality and liberty is the basic sole idea of the leftist philosophy, so providing social equality. Now here the government would provide support to the disadvantaged group. However, under rightists, they have a strong feeling for nationalism and the basic idea is driven by the market forces. So you have the market forces that come into play, and it's not merely that the government which is providing help to each and everyone. The next is the types of governments. Now here we have explained few of the types. There are many of the students get confused between few of these terms, so we'll understand those in detail. The first is democracy. Democracy means people give power to the government, so it's government of the people, for the people and by the people. That's the basic definition of democracy. So you have the government that explains each and every action to the people. So people help elect the government and government explains each and every action that it is doing to the people. So a common act under democracy for nowadays that is popular is the RTI, right to information. So that's again government is explaining each and every act to the people. The next is monarchy. Monarchy is where you have the king, queen or a small group of people who come to power and they make the decision. So once they come to power, they don't explain or defend their action. They give the orders and those are to be followed by the common man around. So the ordinary people, the common man of the region, follow the orders of the queen and the monarch, that's the king, queen or the small group of people who is elected. But they have no, the ordinary man cannot question, or the king will not defend the actions that they are doing. They can do as per their choice and they need not explain those to the ordinary man. Under aristocracy, it's a kind of bit deviation or a bit, I would say, extract of the monarchism itself. Under aristocracy, you have the noble birth that holds the heredity. So the son of the king would become the king. So that's a kind of aristocratic system where you have the hereditary titles. So Queen Elizabeth, so the next successor would again become Queen Elizabeth II. So that's a kind of aristocratic setup. Under dictatorship, there is absolute authority. So Hitler and Mussolini are good examples of dictatorship. We'll study more about Hitler and Mussolini when we'll cover history topics. So there is absolute authority, that means whatever has been ordered has to be followed. The next is not a part of exactly the types of government, but we are discussing this here because this is the most common setup that's prevalent in United States and has been in news recently. So you have in United States, you have two parties, political parties, the Republican parties and the Democrats. Democrats were the left wings, so they worked around social equality, liberty to all and concepts like those. So Obama was a predominant follower of, was a Democrat. And then you have the Republicans who follow the right wing, the philosophy that we have already talked about, which talks about authority and individualism. And Trump is a Republican. So for with the present day elections of United States, this has been in news and we have included it here. However, it's not exactly the part of the types of the government. It was important, hence we are discussing it here. The next is India and the democratic government. So India is predominantly a democratic government. So it's a government of the people, for the people, by the people. People have the power to elect the leaders. Leaders are answerable to the people from whom they are elected. People rule themselves by participating, so they feel that they are a part of the democratic setup. Again, ours is a representative democracy. So how it differs from an exact democracy? A representative democracy means people don't participate directly in the election process. So they have a kind of election process where they give vote to a person who would represent them as a part of the government. They themselves are not the part of that government mechanism. So people elect the person through the process of election. We'll discuss the process of election in the further lectures. And then you have the representatives that come up. The representatives take decision, and those decisions are given forward to the people. Again, one of the important aspects of the democratic setup is the universal adult franchise, that is, all adults in the country have the right to vote. Now, this is a very, very important concept. Before 1947, that is before independence, there was a small minority of people who were allowed to vote. Women and poor were excluded from voting, and even from the men's, they were predominantly the educated elite class that was given the right to vote. However, Gandhiji, in his Young India, in 1931, demanded the universal adult franchise, and he said, I cannot believe a system where a person who has wealth has the right to vote, but a person who has character but no wealth has no right to vote. So there is something that should be demanded, and therefore we look forward for a universal adult franchise system. Again, it was not only restricted to India. This movement was running across the globe. So you have different parts of the world where you have the similar period of independence movement that was running. During the First World War specifically, there was very less representation of the poor minorities and the women. Again, it was in the First World War itself that the women came into play, and they kind of started the women's suffrage movement. The women's suffrage movement talked about again the right to the woman, and this ultimately led to providing the rights in 1920 in United States for the women to vote, and in 1928 in UK for women to vote. So all this was a kind of bit contemporary worldwide, where there was a common movement and a revolution which talked about the universal suffrage, the universal adult franchise and the women's suffrage movement. So with this we cover the chapter 3. We'll be covering more topics in political science in the upcoming lectures. You can subscribe to our channel for further details. Have a good day ahead.